This session, I will be seeing the what are the different types of risk, what are the different types of risk, what is the impact of this particular risk in an IT automated environment or IT environment. In the previous session, we discussed what is an automated environment, what are the benefits, what are the advantages, what is the understanding about the, what are the things or what are the aspects the auditor has to get an understanding to about the particular automated environment, what has to be documented. Now, in today's session, we'll be covering what are the different kinds of risk and controls in a particular information technology environment. What are the impact or how these particular risks impact the course of audit? What are the controls that can be put in place to overcome or to prevent or detect such kind of risk and correct them in the future, correct them from not happening in the future? So now we'll see what are the different kinds of risk and controls. So first, a risk and control is about inaccurate processing of data or processing inaccurate data. Inaccurate processing of data means, inaccurate processing means you have the source data, whatever is the transactions, whatever is the source data, the basic raw data, that is correct or reliable. But there is some kind of a mistake while I'm doing the computation, while the system is doing the computation. It could be because of any wrong rules defined, or it is no proper syntax defined, or it could be any kind of a computational or arithmetic error within the system that is not properly corrected. So it could be because of inaccurate processing, or sometimes it could be because of processing inaccurate data means what? Processing is correct, whatever is the computation that has to be done, that is being done by the system accurately, there is no doubt about it, but whatever is the source data that is being fed to the system is wrong. System data, source data is not reliable and accurate. So in such cases, it happens, or there is a case called as processing inaccurate data. So they could be, firstly, they could be two kind of risk. One is processing inaccurate data or inaccurate processing of data. Now, or sometimes data might be wrong, processing might also be wrong. Sometimes the data, there could be some not very reliable source data, whatever rules that is defined, it is not achieving the particular sole or required objective. So what happens here? In such cases, data is wrong as well as processing is wrong. So it will be inaccurate processing of inaccurate data. Both it could be there. Sometimes data, whatever the data, whatever you are giving into the system, it is correct. But sometimes it has been doing the same kind of a particular processing for a very long time. Now, I need certain other aspects also to be covered while doing the computation or processing. Certain things has to be in case. Say, for example, when GST was introduced, the systems were normally, they were computing a service tax or excise duty. Like now, there is a kind of a change where I need to update the system or make changes to the system. So now the same kind of data, if I'm giving, it is a reliable data, but now since there is a compliance or regulatory requirement that GST has to be calculated, there is a necessary for changing the system or making the necessary updations to the system. So the next risk could be failure to make the necessary changes to the system or programs. I'm not changing the system. Same system it is being used, but it has become obsolete. It is not serving the purpose for the current scenario. Now, even in depreciation, when we charge 40% depreciation to your IT or computers, the reason is it becomes very obsolete in a very quicker time. Every now and then new technologies comes, new kind of softwares, new updates, new patches come. What happens? The older ones are getting outdated at a very fast rate. So again, there should be, at the correct time, proper changes should be made to the system. Else failure to make the changes will be again a risk. Now, I told you proper security and controls are much, security and control wise, your IT systems are much better if proper security controls and segregation of duties are implemented. Now, say in one case, there is no proper segregation of duties implemented. Say in the previous example, I told you, a particular person who is placing the or approving the particular purchase order, he is making entries into the system. There is no proper segregation of duties. Or a person who is making the entries with respect to the debtors, he is also collecting the cash. There is no proper segregation of duties maintained. In such cases also, it is a huge risk, because even in human manual intervention, like the risk could be minimized to a like giving the particular person changing the roles. But here, one person is doing the same thing for a long time. It is difficult to detect if no proper segregation of duties is defined. Similarly with access. Say, for example, it need not be segregation of duties alone. The particular person who is having the access or who is having the super access. Super access means he is having a greater access to various activities. He has a write, read, print, different types of access is given to that particular person. Might be a system administrator also. This person, he can misuse his responsibilities. He can give or share that particular data or particular credentials with another person, and an unauthorized person can also access the data. So unless or until, it could be circumvention of controls, or unauthorized access could happen if no proper controls are there. So if weak passwords, password management is very, very poor. No strong passwords are given. Passwords is not changed in a regular period of time. Or even if I put like 5 to 6 times, if I enter the password wrong also, it will not ask you for any kind of a verification. How many, any number of times I can use different kind combinations of password and I can crack into the system. The password security is very, very weak. There is no proper locks being created. So once this password attempt, say for example, there is a hacker, a person who is entering the system for some unethical means, okay? So some kind of a self-motive, like for example, money or any kind of financial, getting the information from the system, unwanted, then using the information for his personal purpose. So some kind of a hacker or cracker is there, and he, not an ethical hacker, he is getting unauthorized access to the system. Say for example, he is trying all the combination of passwords. Now, if the security system was too good, what happens? There will be a log created, like how many times which person has tried to log into the system, what are the combination of passwords he used, what time he has logged. Now, by verification of the log, I can, or the particular system personnel can understand there is some kind of an unauthorized entry. 20 times a password has been attempted. They have been tried to log into the system. After 3 attempts, then it should ask for some kind of verification so as to him to continue. Like in even in our mobiles, like if you have a kind of pattern lock or if you have a password lock, 3 to 4 times if you press the wrong password, then it will ask for 30 seconds you wait and then you try the next pattern. There's some kind of a control aspect there. So similarly in systems also, there should be some kind of a control aspect in place. Now, excessive access or privileged access. Similarly, unauthorized access, say another thing could be excessive access or privileged access. What is that? Some persons, same thing what I told you, same as a person having a super access. He has excess access than what is required for his particular roles and responsibility. Normally, in a role-based access control, access will be given to those persons who has or who is working on a particular function or who is having a particular responsibility. So, say for example, that particular person is he's working on a particular role or he has a particular responsibility to do a particular job. When I am assigning an access control, when the IT personnel is assigning, system administrator is assigning the roles to him or access to those particular roles, it should be minimal. He should not have any excess roles that is assigned to him. Whatever is required for doing or executing the functions or his particular roles and responsibilities should only be given. Minimum access should be given to do his functions alone. So no excessive access or privileged access should be given. Then lack of segregation of duties, unauthorized access, direct data changes. That means what? Instead of changing the system, getting an access, changing it somewhere, directly in the production system or the live system, that is the system which is implemented or everything has been tested and a program has been created, everything has been tested, it is implemented. Now, in the implemented system, I'm trying to make a change. I'm making a change there. So, in the direct data changes, what happens? Okay? There will be manipulation of data. What data is supposed to be obtained is not being obtained. So, in such cases also, there is a threat or there is a risk. Now, laws of data. That is a basic one. Any person unauthorized entry into the system, it could either result in manipulation of data, changing or modifying the data or destroying the data, whatever is there in the computer, I need not take that particular data. No theft of data is happening, no modification of data, I'm just destroying the data in that. I won't be able to work with that particular data anymore, or I will be just losing the data, taking all the data, copying it to another device, or I'm just taking, removing the data from the system. So the risk could be in any way. It could be either, because with respect to access alone, it could be either unauthorized access, super access, privileged or excessive access, or lack of segregation of duties. Now, sometimes failure to make changes could happen to the system, or unauthorized person can make changes to the system also. Sometimes what happens, there could be loss of data, modification or manipulation of data, or sometimes even it could be relating to inaccurate processing of data. So inaccurate processing or processing inaccurate data. So these are all the risks and controls that is associated with a IT or automated system. Now, what is the impact of the IT related risk? What is the impact? Where does it impact? Now, when these kind of risks are encountered by or in a particular IT system, it could have an impact on the audit in n different ways. So basically, there are three different ways in which it can have an impact on the audit. One is with respect to substantive audit, one is with respect to compliance, and one with respect to reporting. So how it affects or impacts each and every aspect, we'll see. With respect to substantive audit. With respect to substantive audit, what could be the impact? Since the data is inaccurate, or since the data coming, source data is inaccurate, or since the data is not reliable, substantive audit mainly tells about test in detail, test of details. I'm testing in detail when I feel, presume the consumer controls are not very effective, I go for substantive audit. In substantive audit, what happens is the data is being checked thoroughly. There is a detailed checking of data happening there. In such cases, what happens here, the data, so since the source data is not reliable, the auditor can no longer rely on the data that is obtained from the systems. So whatever data is there, it is wrong. Source data is wrong, or sometimes data processing is wrong. In both the cases also, that particular auditor cannot rely on the data obtained from the systems. That is one thing. Then again, what happens, since the data is cannot, I cannot rely completely on the data, in order to obtain the required audit evidence, I need more audit evidence than that is required, because there is some problem with the source data or some problem with the reliability of the information obtained from the system. More effort is required, more audit evidence has to be obtained, more hours has to be spent by the particular auditor for thoroughly testing the completeness and accuracy of that particular data. So as a result, additional work has to be done by the auditor. It is not just I can just rely on the controls, or I can rely on the particular data and go ahead. I have to completely check for the accuracy and completeness of the data, and as a result of which, it should be tested thoroughly. There is one thing with respect to substantive audit. Now, with respect to controls, how it impacts the controls, impact on control audit, compliance. Since there is no proper, the controls are ineffective, or since I, as I told you, the system is not updated properly, or excessive access has been given, or privileged access has been given to a person, no particular segregation of duties, there is no proper controls in place. And what happens when the controls are not in place, the auditor cannot completely rely on the controls, automated controls, it cannot rely on the controls. He cannot rely on whether the particular system is computing correctly, whether the arithmetic accuracy is correct, or whether the accounting procedures, whatever is built in the particular application, is doing its particular job properly. He cannot completely rely on that. So completely IT dependent controls are, say for example, it need not be within the control, IT dependent controls itself. Sometimes it might be producing wrong data, and this data will be used by the persons to arrive at some kind of information. So I can not only depend on the system, but also on the information or the decision that is being given by the user or by the particular management. So again, it will affect both, not just the system control, but also the information or the decision that is given by the user. Now, again, whatever reports that is being produced by the system, I have to check it for on a substantive basis. Since the controls are weak, automatically I'll be going for a test of details. So here, when the controls are weak, I cannot rely on the controls. My time and effort is increased because I have to again recheck the calculations, procedures, everything. I cannot rely on the IT dependent manual controls also. I have to do a substantive checking. More audit work will be required. More time and effort is required. That is another thing. Now, impact, and sometimes for example, impact on reporting. What happens is when I'm doing excessive work, I'm doing a detailed thorough testing to make sure that the data is complete and accurate, that I'm making sure that the controls are working fine, and I'm also when these two are not getting thoroughly impacted, your substantive and your control procedures are getting impacted, the impact comes in the report too. What happens? Whenever there is some kind of a material weakness, some kind of a weakness within the implementation of controls, how the risks are addressed, however the risks are not addressed properly. In such cases, what happens is the auditor has to communicate to the management or those charged with governance, depending upon the materiality of the weakness. A significant weakness means it has to be communicated to those charged with governance. Now, because of this, because of these particular weaknesses, it will have an impact on the report that is given by the auditor. Sometimes it might be he has to give a qualified report or a modified report. It is no longer an unqualified or unmodified report. So now, what are the different kinds of impact of this particular IT-related risk is? One is on the substantive audit, one is on the compliance or control audit, and one is on the reporting part. Compliance part, what happens is, since the data is wrong, source data is not reliable or not accurate, or the processing is not accurate, auditor cannot depend on the data obtained from the systems. So it has to be again tested repetitively or on a substantive or thorough basis for completeness and accuracy. More audit evidence will be required. Now, controls, when the controls are not very strong, or if they're, how it impacts the controls is, you cannot rely on the automated controls processing. What is the processing that is done in the system, arithmetical accuracy of the system, or how the operations or procedures are processing the data, he cannot be completely dependent on that. And again, for this particular purpose, again, substantive testing has to be done, detailed testing has to be done, double the effort happens. Because of all this, if there is any kind of material weaknesses, what happens in case of any kind of material weaknesses, it has to be reported to those charged with governance, and it will also have a subsequent effect of modified opinion, auditor's report and the auditor's report. So these are basically the different impacts of this particular related risk. Now, what are the types of controls? We saw the risk, what is the impact? Now, in order to overcome or in order to negate or mitigate this particular risk, reduce the severity of this particular risk, I'll use some kind of controls. So what are the controls I use? One of the controls I use is, there are three types of controls in an IT or IT environment, automated environment. One is general IT controls, one is application controls, and one is IT dependent controls. So when I'm telling about general IT controls, what are general IT controls? So basically, general IT controls are, these are procedures, any normal policies and procedures that is defined by the organization that is not specific to any one particular application. So in the controls, we saw three types of controls. One is general, one is application, and one is IT dependent controls. So we'll see each and every control part by part. First is general IT control. General IT controls are policies and procedures which relate to many applications. It's not specific to any one particular applications. Say for example, you have a CCTV or a surveillance system at home. This surveillance system is present in all the particular rooms or other pivotal areas, and this is actually monitoring whatever is happening within the house, and it gives you the recording of that. This is a general control. This is applicable to every particular room. Now, just for example, you have your refrigerator, you have your safe, you have a door lock, or you have the refrigerator key. This particular key or this door lock or the safe lock is applicable, or this protects only that particular equipment or that particular element. Say for example, your refrigerator or your safe or your particular cupboard. This is not a general control. This is specific to one particular application. So similarly, any control that is not a general control, it is only specific to a particular application. These are called as your application controls. So this application control, it could be both manual and automated. Say for example, in the door or safe example itself, we have different types of door locks, right? We have the bolting door lock where we have to some manual basis. We have cipher locks or biometric, which is both manual and automated. You have to press it or you have to give your fingerprint scan or an iris scan, or it could be any combination of PIN numbers. It is automated. So your application control could be both manual as well as automated, and any particular IT application, it will be embedded to protect that particular application in order to prevent the risk or mitigate the risk for that particular application alone. Now, your lightning arresters. So these are application controls which is specific to a particular application, and basic objective of these particular controls is to ensure three things. One is accuracy, integrity, and completeness of data. So basically, they strive in achieving the three things: integrity, accuracy, and completeness of data specific to that particular application. Whereas general controls, they relate to many a particular applications, not specific to any particular application. So basically, general controls are implemented in order to protect the data. They are security of data and also integrity. So two objectives is integrity and security of data. And when these controls are there only, it will actually enhance or it will support the efficient functioning of the application controls. Now, say for example, in the example, I have a surveillance system. It is there in the whole of my house. Okay, now I have a particular lock to a particular safe. Also, I have an automated control, or say for example, I have a bolting door lock for a particular safe or a particular room. Now, if this particular general control is not working, I want to see who has attempted to open that particular safe. Will I be able to detect that? Or will I be able to correct or prevent the future occurrence of that particular? Say someone has a duplicate key, or someone has make sure that they are opening the particular door. Now, application control has already been surpassed. But now if I want to check who has done this, or who has actually opened, or who has actually tried to break open that particular door, I need the general controls to be effective. So general controls, they support the functioning of the application controls. So basically, there are controls over four main areas in a particular system where processing happens. One is in your data center and network operations. It will include the controls on that, your program change, your security aspects, access security, and finally with your application system, development, acquisition, and maintenance. Acquisition, development, and maintenance. So basically, it covers, general control covers the following. What are the things? One is your data center and network operations first, program change, access security, and your application. So actually, it is in the way, the chronologically, it will come like your data center and network operations, your application system acquisition, then you develop, and then you maintain. That happens. Then what happens? Program change. If there is any kind of modification that is required, what I have to do. And finally, the access security. That will also come into picture. Now, before going in detail, we'll also discuss what is IT-dependent controls. So basically, we told what are general controls and automated application controls. So there is another category of controls called as IT-dependent controls. What are IT-dependent controls? So these controls are basically, these are combination of manual and automated controls. But these are basically manual controls, but they will depend on something or some kind of information from the systems to start or for the effective functioning of manual control. Say for example, there is a kind of, somebody is trying to log into the system. Unauthorized login is there happening within the system. Now, I want to make sure that every time there is an unauthorized entry that is happening, that is any person who is attempting to log into the system by entering a wrong password more than thrice, then a log or exception report will be created by system. System creates some kind of a report, an exception report or a log. On seeing this particular exception report or seeing this particular log, the particular system administrator or the particular person has to go and block that particular person from accessing the system or has to deny the access to that particular system to that particular person. Now, one portion of that giving the exception report log, it is an automated part, whereas working or depending on the report produced by this particular, the IS personnel or the system administrator is working based on the report produced by that. That is a manual process. So this is basically a manual control, but it uses some form of data from the a report produced by the IT systems. And even though the control is performed manually, what happens is how effective these controls are being performed manually depends on what is the data that is obtained, reliability of the data. So effectiveness in this particular control depends upon the data that is obtained from the system. Say for example, there is an unauthorized login, unauthorized access to the system. System is not producing any kind of error report, no kind of exception report, no logging, but there is some kind of unauthorized access. Will the particular manual controls or will the system administrator, will he be able to function effectively based on this report? Say for example, your logging procedures are there, but say for example, the system time is not synchronized with the actual time. What happens? Synchronized means whatever time is being shown in your system is not same as the actual time. So even though a log is produced, the time shown there will be different. So will it be of that much use to that particular person who is actually reviewing or the using these particular reports? No. By the time he comes and arrives and changes the access security or access regulations or access rules to that particular user, maximum damage would have been done. So again, this is one small example. So what happens when the source data is not reliable, then the effectiveness of such controls is very, very less. So since both your application controls and your IT dependent controls, both are dependent, inherently they depend on IT, for both of them to be effective, because both of them are depending on that particular IT automated environment, so both to be effective, your general control should be very, very effective. So until and unless your general controls are effective, these both IT as well as your automated controls will not be functioning properly. Now, what are the different types of general controls? I told you, one is with respect to data center. Data center means what? How the production systems are processed to meet the financial reporting objective. How the production systems are processed to meet the financial reporting objective means normally it will cover what? It will cover how the computer operations are managed, overall computer operations, how it is managed. Then say for example, I'm taking the example of a small catering business. Say some kind of an order is being given by a client to that catering business. Now the catering business or the particular catering agency has many roles. One is to produce that particular product at the correct time on that particular day and deliver it to the client. That is one particular function. So that here they have to acquire the raw materials, do the cook or particular recipes, make the particular recipes and then deliver. And then they also have to serve. Yeah, say for example, it is a marriage. They have to serve also. They are serving the visitors or the persons who are attending the particular function. Now, invitees, all the invitees are being served also. So they have the basic functions of preparing the food, obtaining the raw materials, required raw materials for the food, preparing the food. Finally, the prepared food has to be tested and finally it has to be served to the invitees. Now, there is a acquisition part, there is a development part, there is a testing part, there is a support or maintenance part. And in order to support all these, there are a number of supporting functions, right? So somebody will be there who will be managing all the activities within the particular system, who has to do what, assigning the roles and responsibilities, what activities is being done, they have to monitor, somebody will be there to monitor, then how the jobs have to be done. Like one person is doing one particular recipe, another person is doing another particular. So whether it is prepared in batches, how many, say for example, a particular dessert, how many batches it is being prepared, or when it has to be prepared, what time it has to be prepared. Say if I have to deliver that in the morning, I have to start early morning, preparing it early morning as early as 3 o'clock. So when it has to be scheduled. So similarly, in a particular IT environment also, the same kind of structure goes. Now here I told you supporting activities are there, implementation activities are there. I have to make sure that these, whatever is being prepared, is not by being taken by any person outside, or it is being only given to that client. There is no kind of a unauthorized access to that particular facility, unauthorized usage if that has been happening, or unauthorized or any kind of rodents in that particular place. If it is being destroying that particular cooked food, then also it has to be taken care of. Now there is a last minute change that is being given by the particular client. Say some kind of change, how the particular catering agency is catering to that particular last minute change. What are the changes that has been done? Everything same I can apply to an IT environment also. Say for example, I am starting with the particular, I am getting the order. What happens? First, there will be some kind of an agreement. Same thing happens in your IT service level agreement happens. There will be some kind of an agreement between the client and the entity. There will be a service level agreement. What are the compliance they have to do? What they will provide and what they are not providing? What is the rules and responsibilities? Now, overall management, in order to start with that, there will be overall management happening. Who has to do what? Scheduling happening. Preparing and scheduling. Batch job allocation. That will also happen. Now, I am doing everything. Somebody is managing all the thing. Now, somebody should be there to monitor, right? Somebody should be there to monitor. So, similarly, in an IT system, there will be some performance monitoring. It is not just the operating system, but also the networks that are supporting that, and also the database where the data is being stored. So, somebody has to monitor. So, in a catering system, say for example, somebody has to monitor how each and everyone is operating. From where somebody has to monitor the store, somebody has to monitor how the store materials are being utilized by the persons working. So say for example, if I am correlating the working of that particular persons or how they are preparing the food, that is your operating system. From where the data is obtained, that is a database. Here I can correlate to the store. I have to monitor the store. Now I have to monitor how the data or how the raw materials are taken from the store and distributed to the persons, and how each and every person is putting that particular raw material to use in that particular recipe. Again, the network communication part. So performance monitoring includes your operating system, your database and your network. It's one thing. Now overall management is there. Batch jobs, they are asked to prepare in job different batches. They have to prepare, they have to schedule, and they have to execute. Somebody is there to monitor, and there is always a service level agreement. Already I have got the order. Now what happens? There will be someone to help the client or any person from outside with the tracking. Say for example, another client is coming and he has a particular order with a particular agency at a future date. Now he is tracking whether what is the status of the order, whether I can rely on the order, whether any changes to be made the order. So some kind of person should be there to record the request, monitor that and also track that. Similarly, in an IT system also, we have a separate function for that, that is maintained or done by the help desk. Help desk function does that, recording, monitoring and tracking. Now help desk, everything is a monitoring, performance monitoring. Now what happens, even though everything is produced, last minute there is some kind of surprise happening. So there is some kind of a fire or some kind of flood or some kind of unwanted material has fallen into the recipe or food that has been cooked. It is no longer usable. In such cases, what do we do? There should be some kind of a backup mechanism. I should be able to cater to the need of my client even at the critical or even at the last moment. So there should be some kind of a backup. So what happens? How I am storing the data or how I am storing the particular food, how I am retaining that. Similarly, how I am storing the data, how the data monitoring happens, where if there is any kind of damage or loss to the data, how the data is backed up, whether the data is stored in any other facility or any other place or any other application. So even though the data is being destroyed or manipulated, I can get the original or source data back. That also happens. Similarly, when I told about this kind of unwanted things happening, there could be some kind of a calamity also. There could be some kind of failure. So how the particular company is recovering from the failure? It could be either BCP or BRP. BCP means what? Business continuity planning or disaster recovery planning. So say for example, there is a flood that is being striking. I have promised to deliver few kinds of a code or programs to the client on a specified day. On that particular day, the flood has happened. Now, the company has to make arrangements to make sure that this critical project or this critical business objective is not being hindered. The company is able to work or carry out the critical business operations. So, even at the time of flood, the company should be in a position to make sure that it is carrying out the critical business operations. This particular function is called as your BCP, business continuity planning. How the business can be continued even at the point of a disaster without affecting its critical operations. Now, every company, every IT company, they will have some kind of a BCP manual, DRP manual defined what they have to do at the time of a particular failure or disaster, the name of the nearest police station, fire stations, all the hotels, your schools, hospitals, everywhere nearby, what happens when this particular situation strikes, how the employees will be working, whether there is any other network, whether which they can connect to virtual private networks, where they can connect to start with that, all the things will be included in that particular help desk in your BCP manual. Similarly, the flood has strike and now immediately they are able to carry on some critical functions, but now it has continued for almost 1 week and it is completely flooded. Now how the particular company will recover to its normal working? Now business important working, important critical operations it is able to cater, but normalcy, how it will come back to normalcy? Even in Chennai floods, when the flood was there in Chennai, there was a time period that the companies or entities took to come back to its normalcy. So how the company is trying to restore its normal operations, this will be included in your disaster recovery planning. How the particular company recovers from the disaster once the disaster has struck. So all these things will come part of your data center and network operations, overall management, batch jobs, performance monitoring. I told you job giving, who has to do what, performance monitoring. Remember the operating system, database and network examples I gave you and how I correlated with the catering example. Your backups, your recovery from failures, help desk functions, SLAs and service level agreements, and finally documentation, your manuals and reports. Now, all the other functions are there. Now I have to ensure that whatever the particular thing is being developed, whatever is being configured, are meeting the client requirements. So the particular catering agency is preparing everything. Now it has to make sure that it is in line with whatever the client has ordered, right? So what happens? Overall, somebody has to manage the overview, the particular development activities, how each and every recipe is prepared. Overall management of development activities, that is the same thing in IT systems. Overall management of the development activities. Now, who has to initiate project initiation? So project initiation means collecting the requirements from the client, documenting the requirements, converting the particular requirements into technical specifications, and now I have to implement the technical specifications. So it is not just a one-step procedure. It involves n number of procedures. Collecting something, understanding something that is being done by the consultants, I have to convert it to a technical specification done by the coders or programmers. Now, whatever is being understood by the particular programmers, they have to analyze that, and then they have to come up with a design. I have to design something based on the requirements that is given by the client. Now what happens? I have to design. Finally, once the designing is over, I have to start with the construction or the development. I have to write the program for that. I have to start the coding. Now, once I wrote the coding, can I be 100% sure that this is 100% true or 100% correct? No. I have to do a testing. I have to give some values, make sure whatever is the actual result and whatever is the expected result, both are the same. Actual and the actual result and whatever is the result that is getting from the system by executing the program, both are same. There comes your testing. And once testing is over, I have to make sure that the particular piece of code or program is in line with the quality aspects as defined by the company. Even we have already seen in quality, I think in documentation, there is some kind of a quality, what are the quality regulations or what are the quality standards that is be followed by each and every firm. So similarly, in analysis and design also, what are the quality assurance aspect that has to be done. Now, once this data is developed, designed, developed, analyzed, tested, quality assurance is done, now I have to convert or bring it to the production systems. Production system is what I want to give it to the user so that he can do whatever is required with that particular system as per his requirement. That is a go live decision. Go live means after testing, the situation is the particular system is good to use by the particular client. And finally, what happens during the process of developing, implementing, testing, I'll be giving some training to some people. I'll be documenting the result, like in an audit, you do the audit documentation, working papers. So everywhere, starting from getting the requirements, converting it to technical specification, analyzing that, designing that, developing that, all the places I also do some kind of documentation. So basically your application system acquisition, development and maintenance involves first overall management of the developmental activities, then initiation, project initiation, then understanding the particular requirements, as I told you, converting into. So analysis and design, then development, that is the construction, then testing and quality assurance, conversion, data conversion, go live decision and documenting and training. Now, these are there. Now, last minute, the client has come up with some kind of changes. He wants to make the change, say for one of the desserts that the particular client has made. The client has made some change to the dessert. So what happens? Now the particular client or the particular entity should be in a position to deliver the modified system. Modified should be able to give, ensure modified system is meeting the same objective. So the new recipe is made by the particular caterer. Now this new recipe should also cater to the needs of the particular client, modified needs of the client. So similarly in an IT system, what happens? There will be a change management process. Similarly, when the client gives or client tells, okay, I need a change in the dessert, you have to change this dessert on this particular event, say not on the wedding, say for on the reception day. Now, what happens in an IT environment? Sometimes some kind of changes also comes from the client. This changes has to be documented first. This changes has to be obtained. What is the change? Change, these kind of changes coming from the particular client is called as change request. So the change request comes, somebody should be there to record the request. What is the change that has to be needed to be made? Somebody should be able to manage that particular. Somebody should be aligned or assigned to that particular change request and track the progress of the request. Say for example, in the customer care also, when we are raising an issue related to a phone or SIM or a number or recharge, it will be allotted to someone, right? It will be recorded. Sometimes it will be already said, this is being recorded for quality assurance purposes. I think everyone have undergone that particular scenario. Sometimes when you call customer care, they'll be telling this particular call is recorded for quality assurance, better quality assurance purposes. This is your making changes. Now, analyze, design and develop. Now, what happens? Test the changes. Test plan, cases, UAT, apply the changes in production, everything happens. Now, what happens here? There is a change management process. There is some kind of rules defined. So once the change request is there, there will be a change management process. Change management process means if such kind of change request comes, who has to do what? Defining the rules and responsibilities. So change management process happens. Then what? Once they assign the rules, actual roles or changes has to be made. So making the changes. Making the changes means what? I have to again design, again analyze and again develop. So making the changes happen. So once a change happens, what happens? I cannot directly give it to the customer. I have to test it. So again in testing, I have to create some test plan, put some dummy values, check whether the dummy values, whatever is being given by the particular user or given by the particular staff is meeting the actual requirements. That is, some test cases will be there, negative and positive test cases. If the particular value that is given by the particular user gives a positive or gives the result as it is required, then it is a positive test case. Sometimes this whatever is values that is being given by the user or given by the particular staff gives a result, it should give a result when it is not happening. That means it is a negative, in negative scenarios, it will be a negative test case. Sometimes UAT testing, user will also participate in the testing. He will give the values along with the IT system personnel, so that is user acceptance testing. All the testing happens. Then once the testing happens, I have to apply it in the live environment, that is a production environment, and any kind of emergency or minor changes also I have to make provision, and finally I have to do the documentation. So this is your program change part. Similar to your acquisition, only thing is your change request, change management process also comes into picture along with some emergency and minor changes. Now, last one is about security. What is about security? Here, I have to ensure that whatever programs or whatever data that is being accessed by the staff or it is accessed by the people are authorized. Whoever is authorized only is able to access that. Whoever is authenticated is only able to access that. So I have to identify the person first using a user ID or whatever identification medium. Then whether he is authenticated, even a password, he can only, using a particular authentication medium only, he can get access to that particular resource. Now, using that particular resource, what kind of authorization he has, whether he can read the data or he can copy the data, he can take a printout of the data, or he can just write or make changes or modify the data, what kind of authorization is being given. So basically, security aspect gives information, authentication and authorization aspects. So basically, it has your security organization. Then what are the different policies and procedures? Then security is at different levels. Your application security, your data security, operation system security, network security, then everything. How the internal network is protected from any other public or any private network accessing the entity's network. Physical security, like you have environmental controls from fire, fire and safety, fire extinguishers, fire brigades, you have fire alarms, smoke detectors. So these are all your environmental controls. Or sometimes you may have water, to protect from water, water alarms, water detectors or waterproof ceilings, pollution control, the systems has to be placed in a place where there is no dust. So all these come under your environmental controls. Access controls, what kind of access, logical access, cards, identification cards or biometric or PIN numbers, what kind of access mechanism is being used. And finally, system administration privileged accounts, who has access to what. Super users will be defined, DBAs, database administrators or system admins, who can access all the different components, but they will be assigning the roles to other persons who can access what. So the last part is with respect to access security. So we already covered data center and network operations, that is how the data is being processed, it is able to meet the financial aspects, what is a program, when there is any kind, what is a acquisition, development and maintenance part. And then we saw what happens when there is a change, whenever there is a change happening, how the change is getting initiated, what is the security aspects, and finally overall management. So basically in all these areas I have to implement general controls. So every area, it let it be with respect to processing, let it be with respect to acquisition, with respect to development, with respect to even maintenance and support, or sometimes any kind of change, with respect to security aspects. So all these I have to make sure that the data or whatever is the system is able to meet the financial reporting objective. That is the end goal. Whatever the system does, provide security, or the system is obtaining data from somewhere else, developing something, giving the report to the management, there is some kind of change undergoing, or even with respect to the network operations, everything, the particular system or has to make sure that the system is meeting the financial reporting objectives. So basically we covered three types of controls. One is general control, one is application control, and one is IT dependent controls. In general controls, we saw all those controls which are not specific to any one particular application. They are applied in general. They are applicable to all the applications. Now, application control, we saw these controls are specific to one particular application and they are mainly for ensuring the integrity, accuracy and completeness of data, whereas general controls was more with the integrity and security of data. Now, IT dependent controls are basically manual controls, but they use some kind of a report that is generated by the system in order for the manual controls to work efficiently, or the manual controls will be depending or relying on the data produced by the systems. This is your IT dependent controls. So your IT dependent and your application controls, both they use the data that is obtained from an automated system, and hence what happens, it has for the effective functioning of this general control should be properly implemented. So this general controls, as we saw, it properly protects the application and the supports the functioning of the application of the IT dependent. So in the next session, we'll be seeing the testing methods and also the internal financial controls.